Hello, and welcome to another edition of Mai Tai Television. My name is George, and I am here today with Hambone. Hambone, could you please turn off our heater? It's making too much noise. Thank you. Hit it again. Very good, Hambone. Hambone, what shall we talk about today?
You all right, man?
I'm doing just fine. Krampus released me back into the world, and said that in order for me to ever receive presents again, I must be gentler, kinder, more relaxed, George. Sedate, even. So,
well,
Jonathan...
Your brain broke.
So, Jonathan, today, we are here to discuss the wonderfulness that was 2016.
Oh, I know how to fix you. Try the drink. It's
good. That is refreshing. Thank you. Have we never done the daiquiri before? Jonathan, tell me about your year. Tell me about your week. How wonderful it is to be friends with me. How wonderful it is to be you.
It feels pretty good to be me. But then again, I'm awesome. Always.
This is making for really, really, really
Well,
slow...
you're weirding me out, man. Like, this is just... You're supposed to be insulting me and being mean and, like...
Krampus made it very clear that if I were to survive another year and have... wonderful presents waiting for me, I need to be gentler, quieter, more thoughtful to those around me. That begins with you, Jonathan.
Well, I mean, if you're going to be nice to someone after last year, you should probably be nice to me. So, welcome to Mai Tai TV. I'm the party wolf, John Hambone McGuire, and this is...
George.
Nice George?
George. Just George.
He's just George.
Just George.
Tonight we're going to make a daiquiri. We're going to talk about, you know what? Everyone said last year was a dumpster fire. In a lot of ways, you would be right. But here at Mai Tai TV, we're going to show you exactly why 2016 was awesome. So we're going to get to that in a moment. But first, I feel like I need a drink now.
Your refreshing libation is quite wonderful. Could you tell us more about it?
So I... for Christmas, treated myself to a bunch of these mixers by Lieber & Co. No, they do not sponsor us, but maybe they should. And what this is gum syrup. It's a little different than your traditional simple syrup. This is what a lot of high-end bars use to give a silky smooth taste to the drinks. So the daiquiri is a very, very simple drink, and I figured, New Year, same assholes. Oh, I mean, so I thought...
I am not an asshole.
Anywho...
I am doing everything in my power to remain calm.
Okay.
Quiet.
So we're going to make doubles, because I feel like I need
friendly.
A double. We're going to start with some ice.
Hello, friends on Mai Tai TV. Hello. Hello.
My God.
Don't you just love this ice bucket?
I love this ice bucket.
Ice buckets are a wonderful invention.
Ice buckets are a wonderful invention. What's cool is I decided to make doubles tonight before I realized you were really nice. So normally, this drink... calls for a third ounce of the gum syrup, so we're gonna go a little heavier. We want this to be a little sweeter tonight.
Do you know what I did before I came on TV
what
today?
What did you do before you came on TV today?
One of my coworkers challenged me to go visit the great establishment known as Taco Bell.
Wait.
I have not been to a Taco Bell in 10 years.
You haven't been to a Taco Bell in 10 years?
10 years.
And you went before the show?
Yes, right before the show. And I had 5 7-layer burritos.
5?
I decided to be naughty for a second.
George!
There is an awfully possible chance that I might get the runs during this episode.
My God, yeah, I think that's a very high chance.
I find Taco Bell to be delightful.
Well, I find Taco Bell to be delightful too, but I've had about 17 years worth of practicing to not shit my pants on TV.
Do you know I've been with my wife for 19 years?
Good for
and
you.
And the first 5, I would only take her to dates at Taco Bell.
Well, because you were a punk rocker and you were poor.
I was also 19.
And you were 19.
It brought up wonderful memories.
It's going to be bringing up something else later, folks.
Mostly of the bathroom in Taco Bell.
My God, don't you have like irritable bowel syndrome or something?
I have no irritable bowel syndrome.
I just haven't gotten diagnosed yet. I am not a doctor by any shape of the imagination.
Extra poopies.
That's lots of extra poopies.
So why are you talking to us at all about how you are making this delectable, delicious drink?
Because I'm getting ready for the smell that's coming later. So normally it's 3/4 ounce of lime juice. I went double because I'm making doubles tonight because I need a double. It's normally just 2 ounces of light rum. I went a little extra on the rum. We're going to shake this up, and...
That's a lot of alcohol in this. I might start feeling a little surly.
Mike, something, please. Folks, feel free to comment. You all know George very well, a lot of people who watch the show, so you're probably just as concerned as I am.
Happy New Year's to you, Richard. We are big fans of your artwork and your love for the creative field.
Oh, it's delightful.
It is lovely.
All right.
So let me talk about how wonderful you've been all year.
All right.
Hambone,
I'll buy this.
As my lovely friend,
do tell.
You have helped resurrect this show from nothingness and turn it into this pop culture powerhouse that we have today.
I really have.
You have lost about 50 pounds.
It's arguable about 30, but
you have
for
gained
noticing.
An amazing taste in Hawaiian outfits.
Hand-me-down shirts from
your
George.
Hair post-operation is wonderful.
My hair after the face-off machine, delightful.
I still don't understand why you have a soul patch in the year 2016, but that is okay. We are fine with that.
It's about all the facial hair that looks good on me, George.
I had one in 2006 for my wedding photos.
Yeah, I saw your wedding photo.
You just deserve a hug.
All right. Okay, all right, that's it. I think I know what we need to do to get the old George back. I think we need to open up a dimensional portal.
What dimensional portal?
I think we need to do the movements.
Are you referring to the amazing television show, The OA?
I'm absolutely referring to the amazing television show, OA, and I think that when Krampus brought you back, he didn't fully bring you back, man.
You're referring to the movements.
The movements.
I have not learned the fifth movement. Will you teach it to me?
I will teach you the fifth movement.
Begin.
First movement.
You must get down further, because you will not be fit on camera.
The Charleston. Do it with me, George. The Charleston. The second movement.
I don't know if we're on the loop.
The monkey. Do the monkey with me, George. The third movement. The fifth movement. Oh, peekaboo! Oh, look at our little friend, peekaboo! The fifth movement, the final movement. High fives!
Oh! Wait, what is going on?
I think we did it!
Where
I think
is the light going?
The portal.
What
I
is
think
happening?
I'm bringing George back!
This is weird! What did you do, you asshole?
He's back, everybody!
What is going on?
I opened your metro portal!
I don't understand. Who is this Ken Lucas?
I did
you?
It!
Why did you bring
did
Ken
it.
In?
I opened a portal!
Yeah,
I brought Ken here out of nowhere!
Down
I brought
it
back
from Oblivion!
I fucking rule!
Oh my god, you brought this interdimensional beast into our home!
Guys. Allison let me in.
What do you mean?
No!
You
she
did not open
that door.
No.
No, we didn't invite you. You're a planned guest.
All right, this is George. This is my dot TV. Are you ready for our 2016 recap episode? Yeah! We got Ken Lucas. We got Hambone. We are ready to rock!
Oh, thank God.
Woo!
Woo!
So what are we going to talk about today, Hambone?
First off, we're going to get Ken a drink because he cannot be up without a drink. We're going to talk about wrestling 2016. We're going to talk about pop culture 2016. We're going to talk about everything that was awesome
I am
in
not
2016.
Wearing, I am not wearing a mask this week. I can drink.
Me neither.
Well, it's a good thing you were wearing a mask last week because that drink I made was horrible.
That was not last week. Krampus killed me 2 weeks ago.
I've been drunk for all the holiday season, yo.
You have been, and you are an awful drunk, Hambone.
Oh, I would
you are
awful.
An awful drunk.
Terrible,
you just become a little weird.
Awful.
Too weird for even me.
See, now he's back, folks. Here, a virgin.
Daiquiri?
Dark and Stormy.
That's a Dark and Stormy.
It's Dark and
Stormy.
Dark and Stormy
is one of my favorite drinks in the world.
Light.
Is there ginger beer in there? You made it right?
Hambo knows I like ginger beer.
He needs a straw.
He can sip like a man.
Go get him a straw.
You go get him a straw.
You go get him a straw.
You go get him a straw.
He gets a straw right now, Hambo.
You go get him a straw.
You go upstairs and get him a straw.
Hey, I just brought you back from the fifth dimension.
Shut the hell up and go get him a straw.
Guys. All right. It's 2017.
Go get him a straw.
Hey.
Go get him a straw.
You get him a straw.
Go get him a straw.
Yeah, I'll get you a straw.
Go upstairs to Allison and get him a straw.
Fine,
I'll
get him a straw.
Room.
God damn it. Don't up the straw. Got that chopper.
Hello, and welcome to My Todd TV. This is George, and this is...
Curse!
And we are here to talk about the top 2016 things that ruled our world.
Pretty awesome. Thanks, George. Thanks for having me on.
This is
this is
our new co-host.
This is going to be so cool.
Whoa. Hold on.
You get this seat.
No, I don't. Can't get back in on your...
I mean, usually I'm the guy behind the camera.
Yeah. Got you a...
I thought that was going to work. I'm never gonna get rid of you. Krampus said if I get rid of you, I get presents next year.
I'm like a bad penny, baby. I keep turning up.
I wish.
Delightful.
Delightful. Okay.
Wonderful.
We've got a whopping 6 viewers, so we need to entertain them.
We had 8 viewers.
There are amazing things that went on in 2016. Yes, lots of dead celebrities, but we needed none of them. That's a few extra spots in this world for celebrities
what?
Like us.
What? Prince, Bowie?
No. Hambone, Kirsten, George. Those are the only celebrities we need in this world. This is what awesomeness looks like.
That's fair.
So the first thing we're going to discuss is pop culture. We're going to break this down pretty easily. We're going to talk
break
about various stuff in pop culture we love this year. This, I know a lot of top 10 lists, you're like, why do I need to hear about what other idiot critics are saying? Well, you don't.
Yeah,
you
no one pays us for our opinion, so suck it.
You just need to know what we are thinking of, because we are the best in the world. We know what's right. We know what entertains you. We know what excites you. We know what tantalizes you.
Hey, it's still
your
sore.
Nipples are already hard.
Well, could you slap me
That's
in the tits?
That's really weird.
Yeah.
And we are going to talk about awesomeness. The first thing we're going to talk about is, since we are in our lavish Headhunters Lounge, we're going to talk about our favorite tiki bar that we went to this year.
Awesome.
Start off, Hambone.
Parker Lounge, Cleveland, Ohio.
Cleveland, Ohio.
Going back in January.
There is nothing good about Cleveland, Ohio.
The Parker Lounge.
The Parker Lounge.
That's what's good about Cleveland, Ohio.
They're going to have a mug, and you're going to buy it for
me. I plan on getting the mug when I go to Parker Lounge in Cleveland, Ohio.
So psyched. Do you recommend everybody go?
I recommend everyone going there. The food's actually really, really good there. The food's really good. The staff is awesome. They're super accommodating. They're super friendly. They make drinks right. They make fantastic drinks. They actually just redid the inside, which is pretty cool. When I went there, they had one little wing of the restaurant that was kind of like for storage. Now they've opened it up, and it feels more of like an open environment for everyone to be hanging out and having a good party in.
Do they realize that their name is like a strip club?
Yeah, I'm sure they do. And you know what? I probably get more customers because of it.
Anyway, Ken Lucas, you are the maven of all things awesome.
Wow.
We've brought you on here to entertain us. Talk to the world. What is your favorite tiki bar that you've been to this year?
I don't think I've been to any tiki bars this year.
You have, absolutely.
I believe we took you twice. Lunois.
Why do you love Lunois?
It is nice. It is clean in there. That's important to me, people. I work in the food industry.
Pretty important to be
it
clean
is clean. It is inviting. It seems like a fun time. We all have a great time at Lunois.
Which is in Roselle, New Jersey.
Yes.
Everybody should go.
Food's great. Make a great cocktail and karaoke.
Yes. Yes. As long as you do not ask for your drink to be weaker.
You never ask for a tiki drink to be weak. Who would do such a thing?
I think we talked about it last time where I went to that new bar in San Diego in the freezer.
Yeah.
Right across like hell to get into it.
I remember that.
I completely forgot the name of it. So I'm going to say my favorite tiki bar I went to this year was Pagan Idol, which also opened
awesome.
Up. And it is a 3-level, amazing, amazing tiki bar. If you're in San Francisco, you should go there. I went there like 2 or 3 times this year. Absolutely loved it. Just got their new mug. Worth the trip.
Yeah, I look forward in the new year. I'll be traveling up into New England for work, so I plan on also going back to the Kowloon, getting my cup there. I plan on also going to the Hookah Lao and seeing what's shaking at the Hookah Lao in West Springfield. And if you guys and gals know of any other tiki bars up and down the Northeast Coast, please feel free to hit me up. Let me know, because there might be one that George might have missed. I doubt it, but just in case.
So let's keep this moving. Were there any movies you enjoyed this year?
I will tell you, there were movies I enjoyed this year, none more than Rogue One.
Really?
And I will tell you, it's pretty amazing when you think about it, because the movie came out within like, what, 12, 13 days of the year ending. It's already made more money than any other movie last year alone. Almost $100 million at this point. I think it made $800 million, almost a billion, I mean. Well, this drink is good. And it really, for me as a Star Wars fan, it was great because I got to see the Star Wars movie I think I really always wanted to see, where you had a lot of war going on. You actually had an espionage plot going on. You actually, you know, what I enjoy about things like the Clone Wars and Star Wars Rebels is that you get to see other parts of the world, not just, oh, they're Jedis, or, oh, it's the Empire. You actually get to kind of see, like, the day-to-day adventure of people who are trying to survive in that world. And I really love Rogue One because of it.
Were you upset at all that it was clearly an attack on the Trump administration?
No, not at all.
Not at all?
Not at all.
All the rumors are false.
Ah, who cares, man?
Would you bring a child to see Rogue One?
I probably wouldn't bring a child to see Rogue One, especially if they love Star Wars very much. Because one, there's not really appearances by the characters that they know and love and reasons why they want to go see Star Wars. There's also no real Jedis in it. And there's the other thing.
No Wookiees.
There's no Wookiees.
No Wookiees, no Ewoks.
No Wookiees, no Ewoks.
That destroyed the movie for us.
Ruined it for
Allison
a lot of
can
people.
Never see it again.
She can't.
Not a single Wookiee.
Not a single Wookiee.
My favorite movie of the year? Get ready for it. Get ready for it. You guys cannot guess. Can you guess? You
Leon
cannot
Beeman.
Guess. No. My favorite movie of the last year, Zootopia.
Oh, that was good.
Zootopia. Have you seen Zootopia?
No.
Zootopia
you must
actually
go
fantastic.
Home right now. Fire up Netflix. Fire it up right now.
It's on like every streaming service currently.
And watch Zootopia. Zootopia, there is the sloth scene
the sloth
in the DMV
the
where
best.
They go in there and they need to get like a license or something. And it's like, I need you to move. And everyone at the DMV is a sloth. They're bringing this movie's a different item. And they're like...
It's pretty
this just
on par.
The stamp,
it's not on, man.
They need to stamp the thing, and it literally is 5 minutes of this awkwardly stamping.
Yeah.
I was on a plane watching it. I lost my shit. I lost my shit. It is one of the best movies I've ever seen. One of the best cartoons I've ever seen. I absolutely love it. If you have any questions, if you want to argue us on any of these, go right on Facebook Live and plug it in. We are here for you. We are there for you, you the fans. Just make sure you rate, review, and subscribe on iTunes.
But like all like 5 stars, yeah.
We need more rate reviews. We are number like 12,046 in pop culture.
Hey, that's pretty good. Because
it's bad. It's
like
bad.
14,000.
We are like right behind.
Burning up the charts.
Yeah.
Wow, you've actually surprised me. Zootopia. What a twist.
Ken, how about you?
George obviously likes to feel warm and fuzzy.
Warm and fuzzy.
I'd like to feel.
I am all fuzzy.
Despair and all, but you know what? I don't
fuzzy?
See many movies anymore because I am
the
like
children,
jaded and hate
the children
all
that you need
the,
to raise
the whole
and
industry.
Take a...
But the last movie I saw was Rogue One. You know what, Rohambone? I'll go with you on that.
Thanks, buddy.
I liked Rogue One because it was a war movie. You never saw the original movies in the theaters?
I saw.
You were born in 79. Do you get
I saw Jedi. I saw Jedi in theaters.
You only saw Jedi.
I only saw Jedi in theaters.
I had seen at least Empire and Jedi
in
theaters.
And I saw when they first brought the original Star Wars back, and I don't want to talk about that.
It's definitely the closest post George Lucas film that appears like the original trilogy.
Right. It's gritty.
It was good. It is good.
It's great.
I did like it.
And not a love story.
I thought it was nothing.
And I'm a hater.
I thought it was nothing like the original trilogy. Like, how could you guys even
four,
think?
4, 5, and 6?
Yeah, it was nothing like it. Like, it was dark. It was well-written. It was
I don't think it's like any Star Wars movie.
No,
like
it's not.
Any Star Wars. But it has that, there is some...
It's not heartwarming. It doesn't tug at your strings until they all die.
I think it has it in the look, spoilers? In the aesthetic.
Aesthetically.
Kind of throws it towards...
They all die aesthetically?
No. I'm agreeing aesthetically, and I said spoilers. The show's full of spoilers, folks. It's been a couple weeks. Yeah. Didn't see it yet.
Yeah, if you didn't see it, that's your loss.
So we're going to try to do like 2 minutes of segment. We got way too many segments here. So we're going to go favorite horror movie. Because there's only two other categories of movie we watch. Horror and superhero.
That's right. Hush.
Hush.
Hush. I've got a friend, Matt. Feel better, dude.
Matt has been sick for like a month.
Forever.
I feel so bad for the guy.
I feel really bad for the guy. So he...
Oh,
text
Krampus,
awesome.
Krampus blessed him with AIDS and like it hit.
He took it very seriously.
Matt is awesome.
Yeah. So Matt texts me. Well, text me sometimes at 2 o'clock in the morning. Watch this movie. And every time I go watch the movie, he texts me. It's always a hit. So he turned me on this movie called Hush, and it's about a woman who's deaf, who lives in a forest by herself, and she gets terrorized by a serial killer.
Terrorized. Terrorized.
She's terrorized by a serial killer. And the twist is that she can't hear him. He's trying to taunt her, trying to scare her, but until he actually murders one of her friends and, like, shows the murder happening, he's going minutes. He walks in the house, he's hanging out behind her, he's waving his hands. She can't hear him. So I thought that was a really, unique twist on a horror movie. So I really enjoyed it. It's good when you have different things that challenge the viewer to sit down and watch a whole movie, put your phone down the entire time. Because many times you see a horror movie, you're like, all right, you kind of know what's going to happen. You know every beat before the beat hits. This one I wasn't sure whether they were going to do because the woman is deaf and she's got to deal with that in her surroundings trying to escape a serial killer.
So Hush was my choice too.
No shit. Wow.
Hush was my choice too. And I also thought it was very reminiscent of that movie that they remade with Michael Pitt a few years back with the two kids. That basically were terrorizing that house, like, were murdering the couple for no reason other than they just...
Oh, Funny Games?
Funny Games, yes. Saw both the original and the Michael Pitt version. Right. Very good movie. Both of them are both very good. But this was a lot worse because in that, like, this is a deaf woman who is alone by herself. And there is a man who's just murdering people, going door to door, murdering people.
Right.
And first, he has to realize she's deaf.
Also, stay out of the woods.
He has to realize she's deaf.
Yeah.
And then, like, he just toys with her. And, like, you don't know whether this is going to be a movie with no good ending.
Right.
Or whether it's going to go a certain route.
Yeah.
And it just, while it hits every stereotype of horror movies.
Every single one.
It also, like, completely knocks them out of the park. So,
and freshes them up.
Love it. Love Hush. Definitely worth watching unless you're a female alone at night by yourself.
Yeah, terrible.
Never watch it.
Yeah.
But I thought it was fabulous. I thought it was great. I loved it. Ken, what's your favorite horror movie of 2016?
I'm a terrible horror fan. I have not watched any horror movies this year, but I did see Phantasm Ravager. So I will say we saw that together.
At a party.
I'll put that on the list because it ended the series.
Best worst.
Best worst. It was horror movie. Best
Phantasm, worst. What number would this be?
Five.
Five. That's the ball that
kills
people.
It's kind of hard to ever compare to the first one in that series. That is the ball. Well, it is the tall man who controls the sentient.
And that's the guy
spears.
With the spikes on his head.
No. The tall man is just like white-haired, tall, older man.
Hellraiser.
That's Hellraiser.
That's Pinhead.
No idea what you're talking about. Okay.
Terrible.
Next category. Best superhero movie. I'm going to start this off. There is only one choice. Everything else was hot garbage.
Yep.
There is only one movie that was the definitive superhero movie of all time, and that is, without a doubt, Deadpool.
Deadpool.
Deadpool. Ken? Ken? You're here to replace Hambone, and you're not agreeing with me?
Done fucked up.
What is your favorite superhero movie of the year? If you say Doctor Strange, I'll punch you.
None of them.
You don't watch superhero movies.
I do. I'm an old-time comic fan, but I, you know, over the years, I've seen so many things ruined. Has anyone here seen the original Captain America? Or
the one that was
actually
on VHS?
The original Fantastic Four is much better than all of them.
Yeah, yeah.
Roger Corman
version was much
awesome.
Better than Trask's version.
So, you know,
have you
I
seen
don't...
Deadpool?
I did.
And you didn't like it?
I understand why people were really into it, but I feel like stuff in the X realm, yeah. The X-Men movies, and I am a longtime X-Men fan. I own the original, you know, origin of Deadpool and all that stuff and all the X-Men books and all. So I will say I feel like sometimes they don't live up to what they should. To what they should.
Nope.
It was
fine.
Pretty good.
Fine. Fine. Fine.
Good. Ooh, and after you sold it so good, that whole lead up, I thought it was going to be a clean sweep.
So I'll let you have the next one. What was your favorite TV show?
The Flash.
Yeah.
Boom.
But yeah. That's hot garbage. It's DC.
Sean Dillon, a friend of ours, turned me on to The Flash.
Sean Dillon doesn't like The Flash.
He does. He turned me on to the show, though.
I refuse to believe.
I didn't like The Flash.
He actually loves The Flash.
I don't like
DC. He actually reads the comics.
Sean Dillon? Reads comic books?
He reads comics.
That's not what I thought he does.
Well, he reads like trades, but he reads comics.
I am blown away right now.
I know you're learning new things about your friends.
So you like
Isn't
Flash?
That nice?
If I say serial nice? Weekly show with seasons, The Flash. If I say so far one season, Westworld. No doubt. Westworld was awesome.
Westworld was perfect beginning to end.
Perfect.
Very good.
I thought the pacing in the first two episodes was slightly slower.
Yes, yeah, but almost gave up.
So did I. But after I got into the third episode, golden.
Hambone?
Legends of Tomorrow. Another DC property. I will say that this season, up until the midpoint, I wasn't really thrilled with The Flash, but Legends of Tomorrow this year has been awesome. Ever since they got rid of the Hawks and they got rid of like half the cast, it's been amazing.
I think you're smoking crack. There was only one definitive show this year. One show that changed humanity. That changed the way we think about Lego waffles. This year, there's only one. Eggo.
Oh, Lego my Eggo.
There
close.
Is one thing that turned everybody onto Netflix.
Upside down.
And that was Stranger Things.
That was Stranger Things.
I agree.
I 100% agree with you.
Does that mean I'm right?
It means you're right.
And you all failed.
We all failed.
Ha ha ha!
See that?
Say we failed, but.
You all suck!
We all agree with you on this.
Stranger Things, awesome. Best TV show all year long.
Best soundtrack.
I've never been sucked into a show. If I remember correctly, you talked about it on MyPodTV, and I had not watched it. Yeah. And I was like, this show is phenomenal.
I watched it in one day.
Phenomenal.
Yep. How you spend a Saturday watching Stranger Things?
I stretched it out.
Whipping back out to comic books, mm-hmm. What was your favorite comic book this year?
Mm. Skip me.
Fuck, you did not read your, you did not do any research
at all. I haven't read a comic book in ages. So I don't want to lie and say I have a favorite comic book
that
I haven't read.
That's because you're very old, right?
I'm very old, but I have about 3,000 in storage, so I'm good.
Yeah, these red.
What was your favorite comic book?
Darth Vader.
Darth Vader was very good.
The Darth Vader comic I really liked a lot, which I thought was really cool with Rogue One, because when, you know, that happened, I was really excited, because the Darth Vader you see in the comic is a badass. The Darth Vader you see in comic is, like, stuck in middle management, getting shit on by everybody, and at the same time, like, pulling fast ones to stay one step ahead of his boss. Killing people left and right. I like Dr. Aphra. I like the other characters they're creating in the series. It's super awesome.
What's that vibrating noise I keep hearing?
I think you're just going crazy because we're in the fifth dimension.
Or too much Taco Bell.
Too much Taco Bell. I think that's your guts.
It's the hot sauce.
That's the hot sauce.
No hot sauce for me. Mild only. Mild only. I love the Visions.
What's that?
The Visions.
The Visions?
The Visions. The family of the Visions.
The family of the Visions.
The Vision family.
Okay, cool.
It's like, I just like how there's little Visions.
Little Visions.
And there's Mommy Vision. And there's Daddy Vision. And they do robot things. And everybody doesn't like them because they're robots. And the robots moved in, the cyborgs moved into town. And there's like cyborg flight. Or like white flight. Or just everyone else flight who isn't synthetic. It's great. It's really good. It's really good.
Out.
And like there was someone that was mean that showed up. Some random Captain America guy. And Mama killed him. And buried him in the backyard. And then a dog dog him up. And the Vision got very mad that his wife would kill somebody and bury him in the backyard and not tell anybody. It is fantastic. You will love the Visions. The Visions.
That sounds good. I've heard that Darth Vader is very good.
It's on the app. Darth Vader, very good.
Yeah. I'll
the girl in there who's like, I'm a big Darth Vader fan. Yeah. I like her a lot, too.
Yeah, Dr. Aphra.
It's just that I got to the point where it crossed over with the other books, and the other books are like, like there's Luke Skywalker and all that.
Yeah, but when it crossed over with the other books, that was the Vader Down storyline.
Yeah.
That was awesome.
So I should continue
It was actually totally worth reading those other books. A lot of times when a comic crossed over with a lot of other comics, it's a cash grab.
Unless it's Inferno. Thor.
Yeah, exactly. When it crossed over with the other Star Wars books, it actually moved the story along in both books, so it was really good.
I'm giving us little hearts, so it looks like people love us.
Yeah.
So nobody really loves us.
Delightful.
Look at a big
wonderful.
Wow. Look at some angry faces. Look, I'm angry.
I'm wearing my...
I know, you're wearing your Hardy shirt.
I'm George Nasty.
Wearing my Delete shirt, waiting for the wrestling.
So, what's next? Final pop culture topic.
Yeah.
Video games.
Hearthstone.
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 You back into it?
I've been on it for a couple months now.
Back on it. You were off for a while.
I was off for a little while, but I got back into it. I started playing. I haven't gotten any of the expansions yet. What I'm really loving about it is I played Magic the Gathering a lot.
It's the closest thing to Magic.
It's the closest thing to Magic. I think it's better because you never get mana flooded, because every turn you're guaranteed to get a certain number of mana unless you got cards that put the fix in.
And it's free.
And it's free. I also like that the more you play, the more you win coins to unlock cards, so you don't have to actually do what I did, which was fall down a hole buying like add-ons for these like free play games like an idiot. Now it's like, if I want to get more Hearthstone cards, I just have to play more, win more battles, and then I get more cards.
Oh, we just had an Ask Cambone Anything.
Sure, what is it?
Is the Darth Vader comic canon? When does it take place?
Alright, the Darth Vader comic takes place right after New Hope. So it takes place after New Hope, before Empire Strikes Back.
Okay.
And everything that's happening in it is...
basically, it's the middle management storyline.
The middle management storyline.
Like, Darth Vader just lost the Death Star. They spent a fortune. Lots of people were killed to get the Death Star blueprints. They blew up the Death Star. Darth Vader's in trouble.
Darth Vader is in serious trouble.
The Emperor's not happy with Darth right now. And Senor Darth has to go redeem himself.
He has to redeem himself. As far as I know, the comics that are coming out under Marvel are all canon with Disney, with what's going on with the movies.
Yeah, so I actually do like that too. But, okay, Hearthstone, I agree. I recently picked it up again, but then I got back into Fallout Shelter, and now I got to make my little people.
Make little people.
Little people. What was your favorite video game this year?
I played a game that came out the end of last year, which was Mad Max. I spent a lot of time with Mad Max, probably
was
about
it good?
4 months.
I heard it was pretty good.
It was pretty good.
Pretty.
It got a little repetitive. There was just way too much ground you had to cover. But if you take into account that whole kind of vehicular battle with ripping cars apart,
yeah, it's awesome.
It made up for... For, you know, the repetitiveness.
Kind of like Deadpool, the video game, which was also very repetitive, but the comedic humor
was, cool.
was very good.
I liked the game.
So, my video game of the year, I played 4 games this year.
Right.
Maybe 3. Fallout 4 took up most of my year, but that came out last year, so I'm going to leave it there.
Yeah.
Then, I decided to get all back into the Uncharted series because you, sir, said we would be playing it together.
I did.
And so I played 1.
I was wrong.
2, 3. This is in wedding season where I have no time for anything.
He loved
1.
It. He loved every
2,
minute
3.
Of it.
Realized how good 3 was, how shitty 1 was. But then I played 4 so I can do the multiplayer, so I can play with you, Hambone.
Yeah.
Where were you?
I wasn't there.
Nowhere. Have you even bought the game yet?
I haven't bought the game yet.
Uncharted 4 was made by the same people who made Last of Us.
Right.
The storyline tugs at your heart just like Last of Us. It's as beautiful as Last of Us. If you loved Last of Us, Uncharted 4 is the game to play. It's just amazing. Amazing art direction, action sequences, an emotional connection to the character. It is such a great game.
Yeah, I gotta check that out.
And I just bought Battlefront because Dave Trainer told me to.
Dave Trainer is an avid gamer. And he actually plays games.
And I just played Battlefront, and wow, I don't know why you told me it was crap. There's all these Rogue One missions.
Oh, the Rogue One missions just came out.
There's all these missions.
Yeah, a lot of fun missions.
I have no idea how to play the game.
No,
I just die a lot.
What are you playing it on?
PS4.
Oh, we're all on Xbox.
No, you are not all. George Collazo is on PS4.
No, I know, I'm on PS4 as well.
PS4. You're on PS4.
Yeah.
So we're going to play together.
I have to get the PS4 version.
Oh, I don't know how that happens.
Yeah,
how do we do that?
Xbox One. But that's okay. Don't
pish
worry about
posh.
It. We'll work it out.
So, that is pop culture.
Pop culture.
We have nothing to unbox
Woo-hoo.
Today.
Nothing to unbox.
So we're going to ask Hambone to strip.
No.
No.
Show off that body, Hambone.
No.
Show off the muscles.
Not showing off. Okay. I'll show you one. See that?
We are unboxing Hambone. We can do a quick game of Ask Hambone Anything. Ask Hambone Anything.
Anything?
Ask him anything. No, nobody's asking you anything. Hopefully they'll ask you something in the next few minutes.
I hope so.
So let's move on to the next category, music. This will be quick.
Quick.
Because we are old.
Yes, we are.
And we don't listen to shit.
Not much.
Not much of anything. Hambo, what was your album of the year?
My album of the year? I actually brought it with me.
Oh. He's off camera. Get in the seat. Get in the seat.
I will.
He's fast.
Back in
He's
your seat.
Fast.
My
He's
album of the year is Parachutes. By Frank Iero and the Patience.
Really?
Really is.
Really? Can he, like, stick to a band?
No, he can't. He's a slut. He's a total band slut.
And they're all, like, his name and something.
They're all his name and something. You know, it's interesting because a lot of times we put out a second album by a band.
I think you need to put it out there who this man is.
So, he's a friend of mine.
That's not what I was asking, Hambo.
Well, I'm not a name drop. I thought you wanted me to name drop.
Who is this artist?
So, Frank Iero was in My Chemical Romance. And he has been in, I think, 4 bands since My Chemical Romance. He was in Leathermouth. He was in Death Spells, Frank Iero and The Celebration. Now Frank Iero and The Patience. He probably played on, like, 9 other things. Because he gets around in the nicest possible Beach Boys sense. This record is great. A lot of bands, I always have noticed, once they put out that first record that they spend so many years writing, it's really hard to write a follow-up. However, Frank's pretty prolific. He's been writing songs forever. So And that's what Jackson Brown once said, the greatest way to be a good songwriter is just to write every day.
Is this his apology letter for making the Black Parade?
Oh, I don't think it's his apology letter for making the Black Parade. Black Parade's actually a really good record. But it is. I loved it.
I mean, if I made a ton of money off of it, I think it's awesome too. But,
I'm making money off it, and I loved it. It's
I
great.
Mean, wasn't that the one with the umbrellas? I'm
no,
sorry.
No, that was the one dude's comic book.
Oh, it's still bad. Yeah. Anyway. That, I'm sure it's good. I'd love to listen to it. I love that you bought it on vinyl, yet you do not have a record player.
It's okay. Just download code.
Can you, rectify that in this new year? Because I can't have a friend who doesn't have a record player.
I'm never buying a record player.
That's something, really. We're going to buy you a record player.
Yeah.
I know. I got 4. Yeah. Like, you should have
Can
a record player.
Give me a record player. I clearly have 1 record.
I'm a music
It's a great
now.
Record, though. It's great from start to finish. Definitely pick it up. It's on iTunes. Or buy vinyl if you are not like me and have a record player.
Ken, what is your favorite album this year that you did not make?
I am, as you know, the podcast producer for Unwinnables.com, which I'm also a DJ, and we did our top 10 best of 2016 list last week. Yeah. My top 10, my number one on my list, Perturbator, The Uncanny Valley. Excellent.
What type of music?
Perturbator is electronic. Retro synth is kind of the category. Ooh. It is that throwback 80s sounding synth music that you've probably come to hear over the past year or two. A lot of people say...
Do people dance like this to it?
I don't know, they might. You ever go to a rave?
No. Oh,
yeah, you probably... I don't know if you'd make it.
No. I remember Limelight.
Yeah. Oh, good times at Limelight.
I went and saw a Biohazard show the same time as like a rave, and it did not go well.
Oh, I'm sure. Biohazard?
Yeah.
In a rave?
It was pretty bad. Do you like neon?
I do.
Do you wear a lot of blacklight clothing?
No.
Not without a lint brush. Ha!
I love the new Against Me record.
It's great.
I have no idea what it's called, but it's solid beginning to end.
Shapeshift with me. Oh, who
did
his research say like a good boy?
I did no research for this. I have no notes. I have no notes. I love that album. From beginning to end, it's a solid record. I think it's got nice ebb and flowing. I think the last one, Transgender Dysphoria Blues, was trying too hard to hammer it home, and this was the record that really solidified, like, I don't need to have another explanation record. This is just a good record.
Yeah, start to finish, a great record. I can't wait to see them again.
And they were great live.
Fantastic live.
Speaking of which, what was your concert of the year?
Dolly Parton, hands down.
Really, just because of the boobies?
Not just because of the boobies.
You like her boobies.
She's fantastic.
You just really like her boobies.
Oh, of course she
does. Did she do a song besides Jolene and just stare at her boobies?
No, dude. She came out and she played easily for an hour and a half, almost 2 hours. Did a quick little intermission. Her whole band are people she's been playing with for 30 years. She played all the hits. She played some new songs as well. She actually, you know, her stage banter is on par, if not better, than Neil Diamond's. And she's just a wonder to see live. I mean, you know, we talk about going on and hitting the bucket list and, you know, really taking advantage of the artists that we still have with us more than ever now because they keep dying left and right. I would highly recommend that you go see Dolly Parton if you have the chance. It's really a nice experience. You can take anyone to see Dolly Parton. They'll have a good time.
My favorite was Fucked Up.
Oh.
I saw them for the first time. They opened up The Descendants. I was so bored after Fucked Up because The Descendants were just... They're The Descendants, but you know what you're getting?
Right over the plate.
I went to the back and fell asleep. Fucked Up is first of all, I love them because they're us.
Yeah.
Like, they're our generation. The lead singer is also like a Vice reporter. He covers the wrestling scene.
Nice.
He talked a lot during the show about pro wrestling, compared like tonight to like the Monday Night Raws, like what's going on with punk rock today. Okay. Just a tremendous show. I love that they mix hardcore and mod. I don't even know what an alt rock. Like, I can't even explain like what type of music
Fucked
they
up
are.
Is just awesome.
They're so different. They're so amazing. I've never seen them live before. I've never feared for my life at a show since I saw Sheer Terror or something. That's good. Bulldoze.
How'd it do it?
I think someone was murdered at a Murphy's
that
Law
will
show.
Do it.
But the only other time I felt like, oh my God, this is dangerous, is when I saw The Gallows. When The Gallows first appeared and the lead singer did the whole set from the mosh pit with a cabled mic being beaten and pummeled by the crowd. This had that same feel to it. Absolutely loved it. I definitely recommend you see Fucked Up.
Definitely.
And that was mine.
Nice.
Yours, Ken.
John Carpenter.
John Carpenter is still alive?
Let me tell you. Well, he doesn't even play music
live. I'm going to give you some hearts for that.
He doesn't play music live, but recently, I guess he got together with his son, Cody Carpenter, and his son's band, which Ray Davies of the Kinks, his son, Dave Davies, plays guitar in that band. They're like a prog, kind of a prog-ish soundtracky band. John Carpenter went on tour with them because they've done a few albums together. And let me tell you, best tour ever. Did songs from the albums, the Lost Themes, and did every iconic movie theme from his movies, The Fog, Escape from New York, Prince of Darkness, like you name it, they played it. And to see the man playing with his son the songs he wrote for iconic movies with the movies behind him, best show of the year. And if you missed it, you're a sucker.
Speaking of composers...
Oh, you're trying to cause heat right now. That's a very...
Well, nobody invited me.
Very pointed comment.
Nobody invited me. You invited him?
It might be a pointed comment, but no. Sorry, buddy.
Hans Zimmer is playing Coachella this year.
I saw that.
That's the only thing we're seeing at Coachella this year.
And I was trying to wrap my head around it. Like, what are you going to play? Are you going to play any soundtrack stuff? Or?
Just piano. That would be awesome.
That'd be good.
I would watch Hans Zimmer live. Just do, like, Nightmare Before Christmas. Like, I would love...
That's Danny Elfman.
Shut the hell up.
Just saying.
Fuck. I think he did one of the Hannibal movies.
No, Hans Zimmer did True Romance.
Yeah.
And Batman and everything else. I don't know why I was thinking
that. No, Batman and Danny Elfman, too. Everything you like is Danny Elfman. I don't think Hans Zimmer's the droid you're looking for here, Holmes.
It's a dead man's party.
It's Hans Zimmer.
Sure.
Fuck. That's not what we're talking about here. Yeah. Disappointment of the year.
The Damned.
Ooh.
The Damned, that hurt too. It's having an awesome Halloween weekend. And so for years, we talked about this in our past episode, look forward to see The Damned, and they were just so fucking boring. And they played the most boring set that they could possibly play. They played the most boring set from the latest record back to the beginning, so it took an hour and a half before you heard anything remotely fast like Ignite. It was boring. And had I known, I would have just gone to the seats. But you know what would have happened if I went to the seats, Ken Lucas?
I heard that show was good.
I would have taken a nap. Who told you that?
A few people I know who went to see it. In fact, they sold me so hard I wanted to get a ticket to go see them.
You know why?
The Warsaw.
They sat in the seats.
But they also, I believe the night you saw them, they played the goth stuff. And not the punk stuff.
No, they didn't play the punk stuff. They played the punk stuff, like, 2 hours later.
Ugh.
The punk stuff was an hour. They played all the punk stuff in 1 hour.
In fairness, I probably would have fallen asleep.
They started the last set. The last set with the punk stuff. The first set was all goth for 2 hours straight.
Yeah, that could get a little...
tedious?
Yeah. I never even really invested much into Phantasmagoria and those albums, but I know there's good stuff on them.
Hambone!
Yeah?
Continue the show with Ken.
Continue the show with Ken.
Well, what's my disappointment of the year?
Yeah.
Musically, I don't know, maybe, and this could just be on me, it's not on the band at all. I mean, I love Ghost.
Yeah.
I wouldn't have made a Papa Emeritus costume for Halloween if I did not love Ghost. I would not have worn that costume several places.
Hey, you got mileage out of that costume.
I got mileage out of that costume. But, I guess I was disappointed that they just put out an EP with covers and... like, Square Hammer's a cool song, but coming off Meliora, I felt like that album was awesome.
Meliora was a great record.
You follow it up with, like, a song that probably was written on the road, and that's probably just the tough part of writing songs on the road and touring all the time. Mm. But I didn't actually see Ghost this year because I did not want to beat to death the things I love about
it. Right.
So the last show I saw was actually with you boys in Montclair.
Really? Which show was that?
Ghost.
The Ghost one.
Well,
was that the one you
the last Ghost
was
show
Was that the
I
last
saw.
Good show you saw? We are not on the air right now.
Okay.
Because my phone died because I switched the wrong phone. I switched to a phone that had 10% left on it.
Oh, you're just bad at that.
We're going to fix that in the second segment because
so
this episode's going to be going long.
We'll
be back.
Still,
we're on right there just fine.
Yeah.
My biggest disappointment this year? The new Bouncing Souls record.
Really?
The new Bouncing Souls record was just not good. It was just generic. It was boring. And I think I'm just done with the Bouncing Souls.
It happens. Sometimes you just find time, you find that place where you're just kind of over a band, and then, you know, 5 years later they release on record, like, just when I thought I was out, they pull me back in!
I mean, it wasn't like the Black Parade bad, but it was still pretty bad.
The Black Parade was a great record.
I've never been a fan of the Bouncing Souls, but I've seen them at City Gardens.
And they're, I saw them too, opening up for Rancid.
City Gardens was a spot.
So City Gardens was great.
Yeah,
we are old. Did you ever go to City Gardens?
Never got to go to
City Gardens.
Because
you're a child. Because
Ramones used to play there all the time.
Well, yes, I'm young. I'm younger than you guys.
You are younger than us. But yeah, the Bouncing Souls record was hot garbage. It's boring. Like, the worst thing that I could say about a band is that their record is boring. A lot of people didn't like the Descendants album.
Right.
But I actually thought that was okay. I thought there were some pretty good songs on there. But the Bouncing Souls, yeah, that was like,
And you're over it.
Trying to do something new, guys. Trying to do something new.
Oh, you know, the singer's got a kids band.
So segment number three?
Number three. The most important segment of them all!
Unwrapping Hambone. Time to take shirt off.
My shirt's not coming off.
We gotta unbox something.
We're not unboxing anything.
We have nothing to unbox. Gotta unbox you.
Wait, look, all right, hey, guys, ready for it?
What is in the suitcase, Ken? Is there anything unboxed in there? You came with a suitcase.
Look, I undid the top. I undid what is the top button for me.
You know, it holds all my masks. Sometimes you need a mask.
Are you going to go put on a mask? Are you going to finish the show, our wrestling segment of 2016 masked?
I mean, that could happen.
It's just sitting there. We only have like 10 minutes of the show left. Oh, God, your ass is hanging out. Everybody just saw your ass. That was horrible.
Maybe I'll get a date.
I undid what the top button is for me, but y'all didn't pay attention, so...
Are you furless?
No, I'm very furry.
You're very furry. Do you manscape?
You just can't tell because I don't manscape.
As a man, do you manscape? I manscape.
Well, there's
an extra load of fur.
Because you just...
What's the best part about being married is...
What?
Someone else can shave your back.
Aww.
It's like the greatest thing in the world.
Sorry, you had that problem.
Oh, you don't have that problem? No. I wish I was more hairless, but
I'm
like...
So that is the money in the bank briefcase.
I'm all masculinity.
Money in the bank briefcase.
All masculinity.
My money in the bank briefcase. I didn't climb a ladder to get it,
but
I got it.
No, you didn't.
And let me make sure there's nothing weird in here.
All right, let's see. Dude, your dildo collection is right there.
Boo!
That's weird enough.
Whoa.
Yeah, weird enough, right?
Can we choose what you're gonna wear? I think you need to lucha it up.
Ooh, yeah.
Well then,
what's
my
preferred lucha mask?
Oh yeah,
no, you gotta do Callisto.
No.
All right, let's go.
La Parka.
It's clearly La Parka.
We've talked about it. I talked about it last night with Allison. Do you think La Parka should be in the WWE Hall of Fame?
No.
Why not?
I didn't. At the time in WCW, I did not think he was like a real luchador. Even though he is very well known in Mexico. He's done that for years. I believe like it's a family of people that have done the La Parka gimmick. I just feel like the other guys more embraced the lucha style, like Rey Mysterio, Psicosis, at that time.
Mask on now.
All right.
Is this a real La Parka mask? Yeah, it's
got
like the strings in the back.
Totally. I have the, the scarecrow hood for it.
I feel really bad now I didn't get you a Lucha Underground mask.
No, that's all right.
Like, you didn't show up to that one pay-per-view.
I'm going to buy my own Pentagon shirt, too. You think the guy would give me a Lucha Underground t-shirt?
Seriously.
The guy, I gave everybody, like, the one pay-per-view didn't come to. Wait, you have a top for it?
Oh, of course.
That's very KKK looking.
No, right. It's black.
Are you a Grand Wizard?
It's
a Grand Wizard?
Get this guy.
This guy.
I like the mask. Keep the mask on.
Does
everybody
chair.
Like the mask?
The
Can
chair,
everybody see?
Man.
How great does this look? This looks so nice. All right.
Nice.
We're going to finish off now with wrestling.
Let's do it.
So everybody's going to... Everybody would drop off anyway. So, like, cause nobody likes...
Exactly.
Exactly. Our one viewer.
Yeah, I'm probably going to pay
I feel like
whoever...
which is us.
Yeah, whoever got through everything else before the feed cut out got exactly what they wanted.
Exactly. What was the match of the year for you, Hambone?
DIY versus The Revival, TakeOver 2, Brooklyn.
Wow.
That was it.
Which is exactly what I picked.
Son of a bitch, it's two! We're two for two, buddy. Yes!
DIY versus The Revival.
Yeah.
I don't think we had a post-NXT episode, which we should
have. We did not.
NXT Brooklyn is the greatest thing ever. That is the WrestleMania of NXT.
Yes.
If you have a chance to go to an NXT house show or a pay-per-view or anything, you do it.
You have to do it. We're going again in February.
I went to... there was no pre-sale, right? Like, everybody checked.
I didn't see it, no.
Everybody checked the pre-sale? Okay. Because then they say, oh, there was a pre-sale. Okay, I went to legitimately five or six wrestling things last year.
Oh yeah. I went to everyone except that last one with you guys.
I went to more wrestling last year, and I think I've been collectively my whole life.
Oh yeah. And I look forward to doing it again this year. I mean, we went to TakeOver 2 Brooklyn last year. We went to Asbury Park for NXT. We went to Monday Night Raw. What's the other one we went to?
That was the end of the year we went to Raw.
Yeah, but I still count that a little bit.
I still count that, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, totally.
No, I highly... That DIY versus The Revival is one of the best matches ever. The only close one I can compare it to was Sasha Banks, Charlotte, that Raw where they had the street fight.
The street fight Raw, no DQ.
And then number three for me would be the Bola match, which was the Young Bucks and Ricochet versus... Or Ricochet, Will Ospreay, and... that other dude versus the Young Bucks and some other dude. If Becker's on right now, he could tell us exactly
Becker
what it is.
Becker will verify it.
Oh, we have two more viewers. That
Becker
is awesome.
I will tell you, though, that NXT, it was, I forget, it was maybe almost a month later where they finally got the titles off of The Revival. In that match, that match was insane. The NXT one, I mean, we watched it live when it was happening at the TakeOver. I watched it the next day because I wanted to see what it looked like on cam.
And it felt amazing.
Watching it the next day on cam felt as good as it did when I was sitting there in the bleachers popping with everybody.
Which makes
else.
You wonder why we pay all this money to go to live shows.
I know, but you got to go to live shows. You have to support the road shows.
Especially NXT house shows, because this is the last time you're ever going to see NXT in a place like the convention center, even though I said that last year when we saw them around the same time.
In fact, everyone that they're advertising for NXT at the convention center
probably won't be there.
Won't be there, because half of them are going to be up for the Rumble. But that's another story.
What was your favorite match of the year?
Anything with AJ Styles in it.
Ooh, yes.
Anything. You got to pick one.
I think AJ Styles and Dean Ambrose had a lot of good matches. So probably whatever the one they fought for the belt at the pay-per-view.
Very good.
Because I feel like AJ really... Like, Dean's a good wrestler, but AJ really makes it look awesome.
Do you know your mask really highlights your crow's feet?
Oh, thank you.
Like, really, like... You look like an old man.
It's distinguished.
Yes, distinguished. Very much so. Feud of the year.
AJ Styles, John Cena. It was short, it was sweet, to the point. It only really lasted the summer. It was great because AJ Styles, you're right, is so good. And John Cena, you know, people love to boo him. They also love to cheer him. And he really is the face that runs the place. So to get AJ Styles to a point where over the course of a summer, he could become the champ that runs the camp, he can get John Cena to take off that armband and leave it in the middle of the ring and walk away for 4 months, I mean, it was awesome. I mean, every match that they did together was almost an instant classic. They were on fire.
On fire.
On fire all summer long. And now I'm even more excited because, you know... You guys saw SmackDown last night?
Yes.
Yeah. Cena comes back, and AJ Styles is... Everything AJ Styles is like saying is right, and they're heating up that feud again. I don't know how long it's going to last. Like, I don't know how long John Cena's going to stay in the title picture for now, but, I mean, John Cena came back. They're signing the contracts to have him at the Rumble doing a title match. I want to see it.
Love it. Love it. Feud of the year.
Feud of the year. I want to say Kevin Owens versus Mick Foley, because... I feel like it doesn't matter who Mick Foley puts up against Owens. It's really the banter between those two going back and forth.
I would say it's more The Miz, Daniel Bryan, if you're going to pick wrestling.
Well, that's not actually the feud I'm picking. I'm actually going to pick Matt Hardy versus Jeff Hardy pre-Brother Nero. Because if it wasn't for that feud, there would have not been broken Matt Hardy.
Yeah.
And that feud, oh my God, when Jeff Hardy put himself through the table and broke himself, it was amazing.
Yeah.
Mine's Sasha Charlotte.
Yeah,
awesome. Great.
I think it's going to go on forever being one of the most legendary feuds ever.
Yeah.
I'm actually excited for that because I thought the actual go-round was great. I thought it was great, and I love that street fight because it really showed what they could do. Because Hell in a Cell is a shitty gimmick. Hell in a Cell is a shitty gimmick, and the feud almost jumped the shark at that point because they're trying to, you know, live up to being the first women to do Hell in a Cell. And they definitely got a lot of criticism for it, but when they came back and did that street fight, I'm happy they're taking a knee on that because when I think that feud kicks back up again, eventually probably next year or something, I think it's going to be even better.
Storyline of the year.
The whole broken Matt Hardy thing has just been absolutely
same here. Final Deletion.
Final Deletion is pretty great.
I mean, the problem is, though, I feel like they haven't topped Final Deletion. I think they've tried to top Final Deletion.
Yeah, I mean, Deleter Decay was really good.
Right. Yes.
But I think it's just also Final Deletion was Matt and Jeff.
I felt like Apocalypto is actually like a ripoff of the bad Wyatt's ripoff.
Yeah.
Because it was so underproduced.
Oh, it's so meta.
What about you?
The Miz versus Talking Smack.
Really?
That is my storyline of the year.
Or Dan O'Brien.
Well, now it's evolved into Talking Smack because anyone who's on he's going after anyone who's on that table. Now he's going after Renee Young. I love it because it doesn't take place on the main show. It takes place on a show after the show about the show, but that's where, you know, The Miz finally got fully over, where he got embraced as the ultimate heel when he did that shoot promo against Daniel Bryan, where it bled over into the show. Now he's going against Daniel Bryan. Now he's going against Renee Young and going against Dean Ambrose. Like, I thought they actually took something that was outside of the product you're supposed to be watching and got you to watch the product even more. I thought it was a great, and I'm really happy that the Miz is really getting recognized, and the Miz is, he's a great heel.
Tag team of the year.
Only one comes to mind. Young Bucks.
Superkick Party.
Superkick Party. Too sweet.
Too sweet.
Tag team of the year.
Tag team of the year, I'm going to go with Sheamus and Cesaro.
Really?
Because they actually got over. And I am shocked. I'm shocked because you're right. You got the Young Bucks. You got the New Day. You have a lot of different people who could be considered tag team of the year. And the actual, like, fighting tag team of the year to me is DIY. But, man, I will tell you, they went from, like, no one gives a shit anymore about Cesaro except the small Cesaro section. No one gives a shit about Sheamus. We put them together, and I'm like, well, here, they're trying to repackage them and force them down our throat. They did that bar fight, and then everyone suddenly was like, wow, we can get behind this. So they did the unthinkable.
They're like the European APA.
Yes, they're like the European APA. That is right on, Ken.
Right on. I have to give it to the Ascension. I think no one has tried harder than them.
Sorry. Are you sure you fully came back from the fifth dimension?
I think the Ascension deserve a chance. They deserve some happy times. They've been on TV.
I feel like they buried won those their guys. First match. I don't know why they buried them.
Do we need to do the movements again?
Fatty and skinny?
Yeah, the big guy.
Well, one guy did get busted on a drug charge.
Drug charge, so.
They are a little sloppy.
So then I got to give it to Rhino and Heath Slater.
Yep.
Because he's got kids.
He's got kids, man.
And Rhino ran for office.
And he did run for office.
Rhino, so cool. I give it then. So finally, we are at the hour 10 mark, by the way.
It's a long one. It's a year-end review. Of course it went long.
Wrestler of the year.
I have to give it to Matt Hardy.
Really?
Wow.
So here's the thing. I give it to Matt Hardy because I would like it just to be known for the record. I think that TNA ring is stupid. I think it's a dumb gimmick. I don't watch TNA because I hate that ring so much. Like, every time I turn it on, I'm like, this looks stupid and cheap.
So what you guys all do not know is that when Hambo was 13, his grandmother took him to see the Smashing Pumpkins. Mm. At the time, he couldn't speak. He had a lisp. And he called them the Smashing Pumpkins. And she didn't understand what that meant. And so she took him to see the Smashing Pumpkins. And his life was forever changed. He fell in love with Billy Corgan. So he said, Grandma, Grandma, Grandmama, Grandmama, please take me to meet the master, Billy Corgan. So she took him. She took him backstage. His grandma was like a band hoe. And she like was able, you know, she had done the deed with Jimmy Chamberlain. And so I didn't say whether it was maternal or paternal. Shush.
They're both nice ladies.
She took him backstage. And while she had her way with Jimmy Chamberlain, she left little young Hambone, at the time Hamboner, to spend some time with Billy Corgan. And that's when Bad Touch happened.
Okay, all right. You know,
literally, that's when they wrote the song that became famous by, what the hell was his name? By the Bloodhound Gang. 2 years later, it's a song about Hambone meeting Billy Corgan for the first time. So clearly, any time he sees a TNA ring in the year 2016, all he can think about is Grandma and Billy Corgan and the Bad Touch.
Billy Corgan was in the Bloodhound Gang?
Yes, he was. He wrote the song for the Bloodhound Gang.
But to be fair, Billy Corgan's no longer involved with TNA.
Nor is he involved with the Bloodhound Gang.
Yeah.
But he still gives little Hambone a claw.
I think the TNA ring is stupid. I think it's a dumb gimmick and it looks cheap. So I can't watch TNA because I think it's a garbage ring. That being said, the Matt Hardy thing was so good that I would pretty much just watch anything that Matt Hardy was on and turn the rest of it off because it was crap.
He was not waiting for that. Do you want to hear more stories of my childhood?
No.
How about your childhood?
Well, I don't know.
I can tell you stories about your childhood.
Lay down on the couch and tell us everything.
Let's keep talking about
you
the
You know
year
I could be here if you need a therapy session.
I know. This couch is comfortable. Covering cat hair.
I heard about you and Marilyn Manson.
Everyone has.
Next, who is your wrestler of the year?
I would like to agree with Hambone, but I can't because I got to give it to this man. This man deserves wrestler of the last 10 friggin' years. This guy, I've been watching him since he was at the end of WCW.
And they closed down and he lost everything and he had to go to the Indies.
Does this man have a name? Because there's a podcast on iTunes.
AJ Styles.
There you go. Also picked the phenomenal one, AJ Styles. A year ago, he was headlining the Tokyo Dome or whatever the hell it's called.
Yeah, Tokyo Dome.
With for New Japan's Virtual WrestleMania. And now he WWE Heavyweight Champion.
It's just awesome.
After premiering the Royal Rumble.
And he is a great champ.
He would never have made it if there wasn't the brand split. So anybody who poo-poos the brand split, just know AJ Styles would be like 4 or 5 on Raw right now because he's not one of Vince McMahon's little toys.
I hear McMahon loves AJ,
though. I'm sure he does.
He has to. He's making him money.
And not only that, like, AJ is like a Cena type in that he stays behind the scenes. He helps people. He gives back to the business. So it's not just how he wrestles in the ring. It's not just how he talks on the mic. It's everything he does.
So he was they're the best year. Who's your disappointment of the year?
My disappointment of the year? Real talk?
Real talk.
Seth Rollins.
Yeah.
But you too?
I mean, I would agree with that, but I'm disappointed Roman Reigns is still in the main event scene.
But that's just your disappointment. Disappointment was Seth Rollins.
Okay, so hold on a second. So we've pretty much, because mine is Dean Ambrose.
Why? He was a disappointment to begin the year.
No, he wasn't.
He's the shittiest.
This is why I'm so disappointed Dean Ambrose.
I'm a lunatic fringe. That's like me pretending I'm crazy.
He came in with such promise to be a different kind of champion, and he friggin' blew it.
He has sucked since day one.
He's a super sloppy, stone-cold wannabe.
Exactly. And then he got a Stone Cold podcast. No, he did. He choked.
There are so many bigger disappointments than that.
You should go back to Jon Moxley.
I think you are wrong.
You're wrong.
What's your biggest disappointment?
You're not wrong.
I mean, I would agree that Ambrose is disappointing before the year started. they dropped the ball with Seth Rollins.
Yeah, I don't blame him. I just blame the fact that they came back. He should have been the hottest babyface in the world.
Right, no, he came back. They started up with the thing with Triple H, and then Triple H just disappeared. And it's just like, okay, now you're on your own.
Also, I'm disappointed with how TNA, what they did with Drew Galloway. Like, he started the year off strong. He became TNA world champ. He was awesome.
But that's not really, that can't really be TNA's fault because they didn't know if they were going to be a company for the whole year.
Well, part of that's their fault because now they are a company again, and the guy's like...
Yeah, but they figured that out last week.
They would
he
have
was
had
the
a,
face of the company.
They would
can
have
you
had,
please make a normal ring, TNA?
They would
I'll
have
watch
had a better
program.
Chance if I Mr. Like Bad Touch was still running the show. I mean, he wouldn't be able to watch it.
Billy Corgan did not bad touch.
Mr. Ham Touch.
Grandma said hi to Jimmy.
I will super kick you. Keep mentioning my grandma, bro. That's
is she alive?
No, she's dead.
Then it's fine.
And she's the number one special lady.
Then it's fine. Grandma will not. Grandma is loving this. Grandma turned you into rock and roll.
She did turn me into rock and roll.
I have no idea which grandmother we're talking about. But the one that didn't speak English.
They probably both spoke English.
That's fine, whatever.
Pretty well.
What are you most looking forward to in the coming year, Hambone?
Oh, wow. Things I'm looking forward to in the coming year immediately is Royal Rumble. I'm super psyched that in January we get something awesome. We get the Royal Rumble. I'm very excited for Episode 8 coming out this year. I'm excited for Gen Con 50. I'm excited for DDP to get inducted into the WWE Hall of Fame.
You can?
I got to book Gen Con with you boys. I'm excited for a full year of our podcast with Edward Coleman, Office of the General Counsel. It's very funny and I have
a lot of fun
doing it. It is about a fictional alter universe, Unwinnable, and he is the lawyer of this geek culture company that has ties with the devil.
I don't even can't
it's
even
a comedy.
Comprehend.
Yeah, you have to listen.
Is Ed Coleman funny?
Yes,
Ed Coleman is hilarious. Funny. You all should check out Office of General Counsel's Christmas. What'd you call it this year?
It was Office of the General Christmas Carol. He wrote a
fantastic
Christmas Carol. Yeah, it's very funny. Very funny. But I'm looking forward to hanging out with buddies and working hard and building my new business and.
What's your new business?
Well, I'm rebranding my art business.
As you should, because you do incredible work.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
I am excited for Guardians of the Galaxy.
Oh, it's going to be awesome.
So excited for Guardians of the Galaxy. Hello, Nicole Adams. Thank you for joining us. Don't sign off. I'm excited possibly to do another Comic-Con episode.
Oh, we have to do another Comic-Con episode.
I'm excited to do another 27 episodes of Mai Tai TV this year.
Me too, buddy.
Because I thought these 27 episodes for the 5 people that have watched have been incredible.
And for the millions and millions of Ghost fans that hate us.
I'm excited to see a lot more wrestling.
Oh, yeah. We're going to see so much wrestling this year.
Tons.
And hopefully we will have a healthy baby by the end of this year. Maybe by the middle of this year. Hopefully.
Yeah, okay. Probably the middle
June.
Of the year.
June.
Gemini.
Geminis.
It's going to be scary.
Yeah, I get it, bro. But you're going to be right.
I fully plan to do an episode from the hospital.
No, you can't, George.
Yes, we're going to do an episode of Vitae TV from the hospital.
I'm almost waiting for Allison to go from upstairs. George!
Allison's not on right now, I hope. So, June 22nd, be ready. Oh, we're going to need a camera guy.
Oh, man.
We are going to do an episode of Vitae TV from the hospital. And hopefully everything goes well.
You're the first time I ever get thrown out of a hospital.
This will be incredible. We're just going to talk about babies.
Oh, my God.
How can they reach you, Ken?
You can follow me on Twitter at Curse, at K-U-R-S-S-E. Find me on unwinnable.com and just type in Curse online and you'll find everything I do.
They can find me at GLK Creative on Twitter, at GLK Creative on Instagram. They can find me at cultofgeorge.com, where I write about all this crap all the time and where you can learn more about how to join my cult. As we all know, 3 years ago, I started my own religious institution. I have 2 members right here. I have a few other members. Cliff Cooper is our priest at large. We are going to grow into the biggest cult in the world. We are going to beat the Children of the God. We're going to beat Scientology. We're going to get up there. We're going to get up there. We want to hit, like, you know, we want fucking Kool-Aid. Like, it's going to be awesome. So, really going to establish my cult in this next new year. We're going to take a little bit break from the wedding photography, especially in the middle of the year. Concentrate on this religious thing.
Or, like, his baby.
We are accepting of everybody and everything. Come join us. At GLK Creative, at Cult of George, at everything. I love you all. Hambone, how can they reach you?
Find me on Twitter at Hambreaker. I tweet like every 6 or 8 weeks. You can find me on unwinnable.com, my podcast, Eye of the Beer Holder. Always rocking and rolling. You know, you find me here, there, everywhere. Definitely go check out Frank Iero and the Patience. Buy this record.
Better,
it's awesome.
It's better than the Black Parade. Black Parade was the bad album, right?
It was not the bad album.
I liked the sing song. Sing it for the children to sing. The Olympic song.
That was good. Was the Olympics?
The best song.
You're the best song.
Sing it for the world to sing. It's like the We Are the World of our generation.
You were like one octave away from Crack Glass.
Written
George.
By Frank Iero.
Yes.
Iero.
Sing it for the Lilla. Sing it for him, Boner. Sing it for Ken. Sing it for the show, because it's all so good. Sing it for our nipples. Sing it for the world. Sing it for WWE. Yeah, yeah.
Well, folks, we reached the go-home moment of the show. This is George. I'm Hambone. Ken Curse. This is My Thai TV. Welcome to 2017, motherfucker. Aloha.
В моем сердце найдете ответ. Я девчонка еще молодая, а душе моей тысяча лет. Чат по рельсам разбитым вагоны. Колеса стучат и стучат.